what she is saying, that she has been compliant, is not true to your mind?
Yes, because what we have seen, no, ako personally, when I asked for the medical certificate coming from the hospital, what I have read was the prescription detailing the situation, what she's been through, and hindi yung surgery that was done to her last year, and one surgery as well, alleging that she underwent. So we wanted to see the real cause of her real situation. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why we're asking for all those documents. And ang hirap eh, they're trying to find ways not to really to attend to the committee. And you know, kung wala ka namang tinatago, di ba, you can even ask us to appear on certain ways. For example, if she wanted to appear on a Zoom, we might consider it. But unfortunately, wala na sila. Kumbaga, they evaded the hearing. As a matter of fact, I think she went out of the country prior to us asking her those certification coming from the hospital.
I am hearing of a country where she's in right now. Are you receiving the same information? Where is Myla Roque?
That two hearings ago, there was an information that she went to. I'm not really sure, but I read it. But it's not. I think it's an Asian country.
Mm-mm.
It's either Singapore or Malaysia. I don't recall anymore.
Okay. And the last point that I want to make, our last question regarding Myla Roque, she believes that any additional information that you're asking from her right now already violates her right to privacy. Your reaction to that?
You know what? Those documents that we were asking, what's really offered by Secretary Roque, we're not asking for so much. And as a matter of fact, sila yung nag-offer na to na for us to validate. But unfortunately, when we acceded to their pronouncement, especially of Mr. Harry Roque, and then suddenly they're saying no. Mm-hmm. So the more that we are bound to ask for it, because we have seen that they are now evading the invitation that we are trying to ask from them. So I think for them to clear their name is for them to be on the next hearing of the Quadcom.
But what value would it be to the hearing if she appears? In other words, what's she bringing to the table here? Puzzle piece will she bring? Go ahead.
Kay Mina, they are husband and wife. And we have seen doon sa amount of money that Mr. Harry Roque have. As a matter of fact, parang 60 million yung nakita doon sa sale ng property sa multinational.
Mm.
And we are asking for the SALN. If we are going to see yung SALN niya together with the signature of Myla Roque, we will be able to find out if they're lying or not. And as a matter of fact, we have to find out also if they're paying the right taxes for that. Unfortunately, yung documents that we're trying to secure from them, sila yung may hawak right now, and we cannot secure any documents like that anymore.
Hmm.
So I think it will shed light, no, kung talagang galing sa sale ng property, because we have seen as well that the assessment of the value of the property during that time was not so high. So what we really wanted is to find out if they were trying to tell us the truth of the matter.
So basically, you're trying to see if they have any connections with the POGO operations, if indeed
correct.
This is POGO money and not just the sale of the property.
Yes, correct. That's okay. Correct, Carmina.
All right. Okay, moving on to Kerwin Espinosa. The day before he appeared before the Quadcom, we were talking. And right then, Congressman Dan, you were sort of not really sure, because you had one apprehension, and that is this guy is running for office. And you were afraid at that time, because you had this feeling that he might just use his appearance and his testimony sort of to prop up his candidacy because he's running for office. After hearing his testimony, Congressman Dan, has that changed? Do you believe every single word that Kerwin Espinosa said in that hearing?
Well, actually, there are those that he mentioned in the last Quadcom hearing that I somehow believe on him. But there are those that are somehow still lingering in my mind if it's true or not. Kasi marami na rin siya sinabi sa Senado that he lied as well. And what prevents him to lie again? So, in other words, yung ating resource person is somehow polluted, no? But, of course, we have to validate yung mga statements niya that he was forced by Senator Patot to tell something that he was forced to say under duress during that time. Mm-hmm. So, I think more validation on that issue must be presented for me to actually believe on him. And one of those that hinder me on believing on him is that he's running, you know, for mayor of Albuera. And I think, kaya nga I tried to challenge him to withdraw his candidacy for him to really, to galvanize yung kanyang position that he was trying to clean the name of his father and for himself as well. And most likely, you know, if ever that he will take the challenge, most likely I will be believing on him already.
Mm-mm. Pero parang marami na rin, kayo na rin nagsabi, he said a lot of things in the Senate inquiry that made a lot of people believe him, only to say the opposite now. Parang napaka walang bigat yung sinasabi niya na pwede niyang bagu-baguhin.
And that's the reason why I really wanted him out in the Quadcom. But of course, that's me. Hindi naman ako Lone Ranger.
Which brings me to my next question. Why did the Quadcom allow him to appear before the committee, knowing that you had reservations? Ano ba yung pag-uusap ni nito? Why were you prevailed upon? Go ahead.
Well, ano yan eh, consensus yan eh. We have members as well. We have four chairmen. Tapos nag-aano kami diyan, nagtatanungan, tapos nagba-viber kami if they wanted to invite a certain personality. And there are some discussion. It's a democracy eh, in the Quadcom. It's not a one-man rule, no? And even the leadership of the Congress cannot dictate on us. Also, ako naman, sabi ko, I don't want that person to be invited. But because there's a lot of members who wanted to invite him, so sabi ko, sige, okay, let's invite him. So may validation din kami ginagawa, and he passed through a validation processes. And more or less, no, when I was trying to see the interview of Kerwin Espinosa, which the first time I saw him in the Senate hearing, together with sitting beside Senate CPNP Bato Den and Secretary Aguirre. And then I tried to look at the actuation of those personality sitting beside him. Somehow parang you have to read all those hearings that happened before. And now that he appeared on our Quad Committee, I'm trying to validate as well his actions. And somehow, medyo napapaniwala ako, but not completely. And that's the reason why, sabi ko nga, I'm trying to take this challenge on him, and most likely he's going to withdraw really. And then he was really trying to ferret out the truth on the death of his father.
Mm. Kasi, you know, the last thing that you'd want to happen is for a repeat of what happened years ago at the Senate. Hindi ba? Kasi baka ang iniisip...
That's correct.
Baka iniisip ng iba kasi, Congressman Dan, it's happening again. You guys are in power now, and you're doing the same thing. Baka ganun yung nangyayari.
Yeah, correct. And one of the scenario that I have seen in that hearing was the pronouncement of former Senator Trillanes when he asked yung mga witnesses doon. Pagdating ng araw, pag iba na nakaupo, babaguhin niyo yung statement niyo. Actually, when I saw that, sabi ko, wow, parang it's happening really talaga. And now siguro, talagang they were with all the investigation that going through ano, and with all those pressure coming from the officials and the former president during that time that forcefully they're injecting this kind of dragon war war on drugs and the extrajudicial killing, then somehow nagkakaroon ako ng pangunawa that somehow or something have transpired doon sa usapan ni Kirby Espinosa and the former administration.
But how are you going to prove it? How are you going to get to the truth? Oh, paano? Because right now, they're the only ones talking. Diba? Sabi ni Senator De La Rosa, susuntukin daw niya. Hindi ba? Pero parang ganun lang yung mga nagiging reaction. How will you get to the truth? Wala na mga amin dyan eh.
Now, the reason why we're actually asking our citizenry, you know, and even the former officials of the former administration to come out, actually, nag-isa-isa na eh. You can see Rowena Garma, diba, nobody talked to her naman. Then suddenly, she wanted to execute affidavit and trying to narrate what really happened. And there are those that are coming over to us as well. And actually, right now, I'm being... meron nga akong isang kausap din that wanted to talk to us, the Quadcom, and we will be validating yung mga statements niya. Kasi nga, yun na nga, ang sinasabi natin, hindi lang pwedeng si Kirby Espinosa ang magsalita dito. Somebody must corroborate yung mga pinagsasabi niya. Otherwise, kung gano'n na naman, then, di ba, parang ano eh, yung nangyari sa Senate might be happening as well in the Congress.
Talking about Rowena Garma, may mga butas sa kanyang testimony or affidavit. Well, this is according to former Presidential Chief Legal Counsel Sal Panelo. And I want to get your thoughts on it. He's saying that the alleged meeting between Rowena Garma and the former president happened May 2016, when fact of the matter is the president only assumed office July of 2016. So how can that meeting have transpired? Yun ang kinikwestiyon ni Sal. Go ahead.
Actually, kung i-recall mo yung line of questioning ko with Rowena Garma, I asked that. Sabi ko, May 2016. So hindi pa siya nag-oath. Sabi ko, president-elect pa lang siya. He was a president-elect during the time that Rowena Garma picked him up in the house of the former president. So basically, may truthfulness ang sinasabi ni Rowena because president-elect pa lamang si former president. Mm.
So basically, it didn't prevent him from sort of, you know, making plans for the presidency that's about to happen.
In general. Exactly, Camila, because he's already the president-elect and he's just waiting for the oath taking of him in the office. So basically, alam natin that he's planning already what to do with this team. Mm-hmm. And most likely, siyempre, kapag yung president-elect, parang kami, pag congressman-elect o kaya mayor-elect o governor-elect, you're trying to pick up all those people that you're going to put in your team already. Kasi hindi naman pagdating mo ng July 1, ano ka
Saka
na,
pa lang.
Doon ka pa lang magbubuo ng tao mo. You have to really try to find out the best of the best in order to help you in your assumption.
What about her insistence that the reward system was patterned after the Davao model? The former chief presidential legal counsel also saying she never did claim that she was part of that of the DDS, if it ever did exist. Paano nga ba niya nalaman itong Davao model?
Kung mapapansin mo, si Rowena Garma was a former she was a former chief of police of Davao, if I'm not mistaken, and he served under former president Rodrigo Roa Duterte when he was still the mayor of Davao. And matagal siyang nag-stay sa Davao. And even, I think she was appointed as sa CIDG doon sa Davao region. And she knows well si former president. So most likely, yung pattern of how the deed, the EJK, she is knowledgeable on that project, and that's the reason why the former president talked to her to plan it out and try to find out who's the best person to lead the operation of the EJK.
Tell me something, Congressman Dan. You know, for the past hearings, whenever Garma's there, you know, she would deny some things, she would refuse to answer others. But when she read that affidavit, it was free-flowing, so much so that there was some doubt whether she was coerced to deliver this affidavit. What is the assurance that you can give to the public that the same thing that happened to Kerwin back then is not happening to Garma now?
Well, ako, sa akin, that remains to be seen kasi we're just doing our part. And with all honesty, walang pagpe-pressure ang ginagawa namin doon sa kanya. If there was indeed a harassment or pressure on her, of course, that will come out. Alam mo, naniniwala tayo sa karma eh. And what happened to the former administration and to the former president and to the former officials might happen to those people who are pressuring them now. And that is a lesson learned for all of us. And ako, basically ako, for my part, I will not do it because we know the repercussion. And I really believe that things happen for a cause. And if ever that we will be doing the same, and then wala naman kami pinakaiba sa kanila.
Can you say that categorically for all the other members of the Quadcom that they never did anything, never lifted a finger to coerce Garma to deliver that affidavit? Go ahead.
I'm pretty sure. You know why?
Why?
Because I am one of the chairman of the Quadcom. I should know if they're doing pressure on all the resource persons that within our own jurisdiction. Mm. And that's the reason why during the time that Warden Padilla was under our custody, well, one of the motion that I moved was to transfer transfer siya doon sa Taguig or sa Quezon City Jail. Mm. We don't want him on our premises para at least we cannot be construed as pressuring the resource person.
Okay, finally.
And, as a matter of fact, sa totoo lang, si Rowena Garma, we wanted her to be transferred as well. Eh. Mm. Unfortunately, she cried and we acceded to her request that yung kanyang anak ay mapasama sa kanya because medyo may diferensya yung kanyang anak.
Mm.
So, yun, we will not do something that we will regret someday.
Okay. I know from a source that there are so many other so-called witnesses wanting to come out and give their testimony. But we also know that you want to wrap things up. This Quadcom hearing, it can't go on forever. So what's the end game here? Plus, you have yet to come out with that partial committee report, right? Recommending the filing of charges. That hasn't seen the light of day. So how is this all going to end and when, Congressman?
Well, actually, we filed also already the dalawang bill, and we wanted that to be certified urgent by the president, yung heinous crime, yung EJK, and the other, yung sa POGO. So these are initial bills that we wanted to be fast track, and at the same time, we have like 15 pa more of amendments, and at the same time, tong recommendatory mga cases that we will be recommending to the Department of Justice. I am pretty sure that by the end of this November or by the end of not October but November, I'm pretty sure makakaroon na kami ng partial recommendation.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Congressman Dan Fernandez there, Chairman of the House Committee on Public Order and Safety. Thanks again for taking our call.
Thank you, Carmina, and be blessed.